Hello, fishing friends. Welcome to another episode of The Fishing Podcast. I'm your host, Landon DeKaiser, and this is where I interview industry greats, average Joes and Janes, biologists, conservationists, and everything in between. My goal is simple. I want to inspire anglers to catch more fish, more places, more often. All right, episode number 9, and this is part 2 with Mark Martin, and we continue our conversation on walleye fishing. So if you liked the last episode, I think you're really going to like this one as well. We talk about some different subjects, so we get into, we finish up our conversation on kind of how walleye travel throughout the year and what their migration patterns look like, and then talk about ice fishing, how it can be quite dangerous at times. And then we get into walleye fishing at night. So that's one of the areas that Mark became well known for early on. And if you've never thought of fishing walleye at night, you probably will after this, because he's got some awesome stories about it and some great advice on you can get out there and do it yourself. So I appreciate everybody listening. Seriously, I really do. I think I'm up to about 1,000 downloads already, which isn't bad. The fact that there's 1,000 people that took the time to listen to me is awesome. And these people are from the East Coast to the West Coast. I'm not kidding. So John McCormick from Maine and Keegan Hornback from California, that's about as far away as you can get from each other in the United States, but there's people from all over the world I can see pop up on the little tracker for where the episodes are downloaded, which is awesome. So huge thanks to you guys. I appreciate the support, the advice you guys have been giving me, and I've had a lot of listeners that have helped me get guests on the show. So thanks to everyone. Enjoy today's episode.
Earlier, I said I kind of wanted to go through the different seasons and what walleye do, and it doesn't matter what kind of fish you're fishing for, you got to be fishing where there are fish
all the time
to catch them,
right?
And understanding how fish move around is a pretty important factor, and walleye are more migratory than a lot of fish are.
Oh, huge.
So we're catching them in the river. You know, obviously there's a lot of at least small fish moving up in the river. But if you can kind of just walk through what a walleye's year looks like, you can start at any point from when they spawn and where they spawn to...
They're moving back towards the areas that they spawn right now. So, you know, like you were in Saginaw. We'll just take Saginaw because a lot of people know Saginaw or know where it is and can understand what I'm talking about. You know, they're nomads. They've been out in Lake Huron, could be all the way around to Lake Michigan, could be all the way over to Little Bay to Knack, you know, from Saginaw Bay, or could be down Lake Erie.
And do they migrate that far?
Yeah. Oh yeah, I've in Muskegon Lake, when I guided, I caught tagged fish that were from Lake Erie.
Really?
And I caught them from Sheboygan, I caught them from Alpena, I caught them from Bay to Knack, I caught them from Green Bay, I caught them from down, well, of course, Grand Haven and Manistee and, you know, that kind of stuff. But the other ones, you know, when I tell people where I caught them, that's hundreds of miles.
Right.
You know? So they can move in one night or one day or whatever, 40 miles if they want to. So that's a long ways.
It is a long ways.
And if they keep going, they can, you know, exactly. In 1 week, they can be along. They can be up to the Mackinac Bridge,
right?
From here,
yeah,
you
easily.
Know. So, you know, it's. But the thing is you're in Saginaw Bay catching them in the river. Well, that's where they're migrating back to in the river. They're making a false run up the river, especially if it rains right now. It's going to get more of an influx of walleyes. If it doesn't rain or water doesn't, you know, and starts going down, they'll move back out into the bay again, and there won't be as many in there. But the thing is there's shad that move into the Tibawassee and the Saginaw right now. So that's the food supply they're coming in there to get. And the rest of them, they're coming out of wherever and out of Lake Huron and beyond into Saginaw Bay. And as it gets later and later, they just keep moving. And when they're under the ice, they're out there in the bay, and some are always going up the river. There's some that always are going up, and there's some that are always coming back. You know, they're just
even in like the summer months.
No, right now. Okay. Fall is a time where they're going to go up and make false runs, and you know, if the water comes up during the winter or the fall, more will come up in the river and check it out because there's food up there. But they just make these false runs at this time of year, and then they go back out when there's no water. The water goes down, they go back out. There's always going to be some in the river, but not in the numbers that they were. You know, they got to go back out. And so as it turns into the winter time, you know, they still doing the same thing underneath the ice in the river. But there's more of them out in the bay right now, because now they're still eating, and they're moving up, and they're moving around in that bay, and they're checking out the reefs out there in the bay itself, because some of them are going to spawn on the reefs, not even come close to the river. And so you got the Callahan's Reef, and you got all these others. So they're moving around the deep water around these areas, and come up and they can check out the reefs and go back down.
Do they need current to spawn, or will they spawn just in the lake?
They'll spawn on pebble rocks and rocks, and you know, they don't need current. But the current is, they'll spawn when the waves are beating on the rocks. So that is current.
Okay.
You know, when it's real rough out, even though it's 8-10 feet down, it's still, if you were down there, you'd feel the surge if the water was, you know, 2-3 feet of waves on top.
Yeah.
You'd feel the surge down, and they'll spawn on the reefs when it's like that, you know, and then the river, they'll go, a lot of them will go up there, but a lot of them don't go, you know, so that really helps the species. And they go at little different times, so if one group spawns right now, and all of a sudden a devastation happens, it don't wipe out the whole species, you know. It might wipe out, yeah, they're stagger themselves a little bit all the time. And then some of them, they go out on the reefs and spawn to stay out of, you know, so there's always, Mother Nature protects itself. So you're always going to get a good spawn out of one of these batches, or all of them, or the reef ones and not the river ones, or, you know, so there's a variety of places they utilize them. So the walleyes do. And I'm sure the other fish do that too. You know, they don't all spawn.
Yeah, steelhead and.
Yeah, bluegills do too. You know, they kind of spread out over a month or so, you know, and it's kind of the way it does with the walleye. So now you got the winter time, and they're coming in, and, you know, eventually there'll be more in the inner bay than there's going to be in the outer part of the bay in the winter time. And they'll be in the river, if the water starts melting and coming and rising under the river, you know, the river starts to rise, I'd be careful of that river ice. It's dangerous.
But I had a pretty scary experience out there one time, actually.
Yeah, that's why I don't take nobody out there. I've seen it before, but that's when they'll run in out of the bay, you know, but that ice can go like that.
From one day to the next.
Right.
My buddies had went out the day before, and they're like, oh yeah, there's, you know, foot and a half ice on the river. And I'm like, man, are you sure it's getting warm? It was spring, basically. I'm like, I don't know. We got out there, and there's guys running down the river in quads. I'm like, all right, you know, there's guys in quads out there. Well, we got out before daylight.
Ooh, that's even scarier.
And when I'm almost embarrassed to tell the story a little bit, but I think it's good for people to hear. When we started fishing, we're looking around, that looks like open water over there. That looks like open water over there. Well, we had got a lot of rain, and, you know, that river was ripping. I mean, we were using big jigs, and our line was just shooting. And we got off of the river quick, and then we went out in the bay, and there was a foot and a half of ice out there. It was plenty safe. But, man, you don't want to even mess with it. It's scary stuff. Because if you fall in there, you're not getting out. You can't pull yourself out of there.
You're gone.
No one will probably ever find you.
No.
Maybe in a couple months.
Yeah, out in the bay somewhere.
Exactly.
Yeah, no way.
I sidetracked you there, but no, trying to save someone from doing something stupid like I did.
That's, you know, people say, well, why didn't you bring the school onto the river? I said, I'm going to tell you a story. I used to go on that river, didn't know any better. And I was catching fish. I thought it was a pretty good place to go fishing. And I, this guy, I was up around the seawalls. The iron walls, and you know, it seemed pretty safe, and you know, nobody was, you know, falling in or anything. And next thing, this guy's playing with his Labrador, throwing a ball up against the seawall, and bounce back. The dog would grab it, run back, give it to its owner, and do it again, and do it again. And sometime during the day, all of a sudden, I hear him yelling, and his dog fell in the water.
My God.
You know, it finally, though, it ate through underneath, and his dog was running back, and poosh, and it was, you know, it got out.
Oh, thank
and
God.
And everybody went, I think it's time to get off of here.
Yeah, you know, that's scary. That rivers, I mean, rivers are dangerous places when there's not ice on them, you know, let alone when you're walking on frozen water. I don't know that.
Yeah, I don't have that no fear patch anymore on my back.
Yeah, I
go out on the bay every day compared to even on the bay, you know, it changed from one day to the next this past year, and we had to make decisions, and we missed one day because it was so foggy you couldn't see where you were going. You could have drove right into water.
Yeah,
and we had to wait till the next day, and it was the following day it broke up because it rained so hard. But there's 2-3 feet of ice, don't matter. When you get the water, you know, coming underneath and working it like that, it finally started making the cracks where they were wider and wider, and the next day it was gone, you know. So we got the last real good day, and the fishing was good. You know, but we weren't that far off of shore either then, because we didn't push it to the max, you know.
Yeah.
And that's kind of the way our school is, a safety first, no matter what we're doing, whether we're in open water in boats or whether we're on the ice, it's safety first all the time.
Yeah.
But then you get into...
Yeah, I got after you sidetracked there a little bit.
Ice, and then you get into the springtime. Well, now they're going to be... looking to go on the reefs, and they'll be on the reefs, they'll be going up the rivers, but you know, there's seasons on the rivers that you can't fish until in the last Saturday in April you can start fishing. So you know, that kind of limits you to, you know, fishing the Great Lakes outside the river mouths all the way around, so the fish still spawn outside on the reefs, you know, like in Saginaw, where don't get sidetracked again. They'll spawn on Callahan's and some of the other reefs over there to the east, quite a bit, around the man-made island. You know, that's where they're going to spawn. And then you come into opening day and through the early part of summer, everybody thinks, oh, they're all back out into the bay. Well, they're still in the river, but they're slowly transitioning down the river in Saginaw, and they hold up down there around the mouth a lot of times. And then there's going to be a certain amount, like I say, that never run the river. They're going to be on the reefs, but now they're going to move off the reefs, and you're going to be able to catch them out there suspended in Saginaw Bay. And then as it moves into summertime, if it warms up quick, they're going to shoot right out into Lake Huron. If it warms up slow, they're going to stay in the Saginaw Bay proper. You know, they'll be in the inner bay, then they'll go to the fringes of the bay, and then once it heats up, they'll go to the outer bay and beyond.
Is there like a temperature that they're moving out into that, I'm assuming, deeper water is why they're leaving the bay? Because the bay's
it gets shallow. Warm and stuff, but it's not all will leave. Maybe majority will leave, but if the food is there, if for some reason there's a food source, they don't care if it's 80 degrees, they'll stay. They'll stay okay. until that food's depleted. So it's depleted. Not so
much they're uncomfortable and that they're just following the food
source. The food's moving out, basically. Gotcha. Or the food's starting to hatch in it further out. But if the food's in the bay and staying in the bay, they're going to stay longer. But usually as it warms up, you're getting bug hatches further out and further out of the bay as the water warms in the deeper waters. And the prey species are starting to feed on the bugs and stuff because they're usually, the prey species are insect and larva feeders. They might be some minnow feeders, mm-hmm. but even walleyes feed on bugs a lot. So, and that's what really happens there. So, yeah, there's that's kind of transition. And then when you're doing all that, you're a lot of times you're looking for suspended bait. If you're looking for suspended fish, good luck, because you're not gonna see that many suspended fish. What you're looking for is suspended bug hatches, bait fish, because they can't move out of the way of your boat transducer. Fish can move. I'll see them on my transducer, but if I see one or two, there's a whole lot more that I don't see. But if I see bug hatches, I see bait fish pods, time to fish. You put it down, you start fishing between the and over the bait fish and bug hatches, and fish will be there. You see them on the bottom. You can try fishing those on the bottom, but not necessarily are you going to be, you'll catch them, but they'll be like pulling hen's teeth at times. Those same fish, you're not going to mark them up here, but that's where they're feeding, is up here, 10 feet from the surface, 12 feet from the surface, and 20, 30 feet, 50 feet of water. And they can get out of the way of the boat. But what happens, these fish down here, when they want to eat, they come up and eat, and then they come right back down. They come up and eat, and they come right back down. So you see them down here, but usually the ones that are down here, they're full. They're lethargic.
Interesting.
They're full.
Sit there and waste my time fishing down deep.
Used to do that all the time because I knew that they were. And you'd throw this kitchen sink at them, and you'd get one an hour for the thousands you'd see. And then one time I figured it out, and now I catch them suspended. And that's why people fish them suspended. They might not even notice. Now they'll notice the ones down on the bottom, but they'll notice the bug hatches in the bait fish pods. And that's really what these fish are keying in. They'll come up and grab something, but having the suspended bite, that's really the key. Is if you see fish on the bottom and you can't catch them, bring it up and fish the bait pods and the bug hatches up above over the fish that you see all over the bottom, and you'll be really successful, and a lot of people don't understand. And I go, well, how do you know that? I go, well, let's see. You ever hear of air embolism? Let's say you're only catching fish 10 feet down from the surface, out over 30 feet of water, or 50 feet, whatever, 25. Your only lures were only down 10 feet, 12 feet, and you catch a fish. And you put it in the live well, and it goes belly up. Now, tell me that fish was only, if it was 10 feet down for the last 2 hours, you'd put it in the live well, go to the bottom of the live well, and swim upright. When it turns up on its belly, that means that fish was down on the bottom, came up, grabbed your lure, went back, tried to get back down, and it didn't get back down. You pulled it in and netted it. It's okay. If you understand what the fish is telling you, you'll understand.
Because it can't adjust for that pressure.
Not that quick.
Yeah.
They're not a lake trout. where they can blow it out.
Yeah.
You know.
So that brings us into summer. And I imagine from there they're start headed back towards the river and the
in the summer, they'll wander all over the lake, all over all the Great Lakes, and they'll go all their separate ways. And
the summer one of the harder times to fish then.
Yeah, because they're all spread out. Yeah, you know, all over the. But when you do find them, there'll be good little congregations of them.
So you want to keep moving, cover a lot of water.
Yeah, that's why you troll or when you're moving, you can see bait pods and bug pods and. You know, and then it's time to stop. Not necessarily are you going to see fish. You know, every once in a while, if you start seeing fish, you know, if you're moving any decent speed at all, it'll just be a pinprick on your screen. And if you were able to slow down just going over them, that pinprick turns into an arc. But you're going so fast, it's just pip. And you got to learn how to identify that pinprick when you're going fast that it's a fish. You know, the slower you go, you know, as you come over a fish here and you're going real slow, it starts drawing that arc as you go over them. And as you go by them, that's what an arc is you come over, or the fish either went through your transducer cone angle real slow, or you went over that fish real slow. And as you meet that fish, it starts here, and as you get over the top of the fish, it's here. And as you leave the fish or the fish leaves you, it drops off on the other side.
Interesting. I didn't know that.
That's what you're seeing. Those arcs are not the way the fish... That's just the fish coming and going one way or the other. Or you going one way or the other. Otherwise, if you were just sitting still like ice fishing and and you're just sitting there and you were jigging and you see your lure going up and down and it looks like a heart monitor. When a fish comes in, all it is a straight line coming through and it stops. It's still a straight line because you're not going over it.
Right.
And then it goes off and you can see it taper itself down to the bottom, or you see it come into the screen and it comes off the bottom and up to your lure and goes back down. As a straight line, almost.
Yeah, I've never used like an actual transducer ice fishing, just like Vexlar's, which
all you see
give you a dot.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So one of the other things I wanted to cover before I take up your entire night here is night fishing for walleye, and that's kind of where you got started and people started knowing you for being able to go out and catch fish at night.
Yep.
What's the difference between fishing at night, if anything? What, you know, if you got a boat, you know how to walleye fish, but you've never went out and tried them at night, how somebody gets started there?
You know, to me, it's easy because I started doing it, you know, when I was 3 years old with my dad and grandpa. And so I seen how it works. You don't want to use, you know, whether you're casting or anything, you want to use a minnow type bait. And fishing fairly shallow, 15 feet and less, they'll come in. They're predators, so they like to, you know, they could have been out suspended. They could have been out in deep water. But at night, they come in because they know the prey species is all in shallow water, and they'll corral them up there in the shallow water, and you know, you can see them in 2-3 feet of water at night. And people don't fish them shallow enough. They come in maybe 15 or 10 feet and they don't come in any closer. Well, them fish come in to where their backs are almost out of the water at night, and they're aggressive, you know. In the daytime, they may be able to see, but I know that all the other fish can see them. At night, they can see, but they know that they've got the advantage over the other fish because they got more rods and cones in their eyes to lighten up the water and see everything going on around them. So they're not as scared to come into that shallow water as they would be in the daytime. Well, you know, a little commotion, they're back. They'd love to probably come in the shallows in the daytime, but the clearer the water, you know, any disturbance around them, they're back out like a flash. So at night, you got, you know, if you got a stealthy presentation with an electric motor or you're casting and you're not making a bunch of noise, you're going to be catching some fish, you know. And I always like to troll before I cast because I can move across the lake and around the edges or over tops of stuff that I want and find where the fish are. And if I want to stop after I make a couple passes where I caught fish, now I've narrowed down this piece of structure that they're on, and now I can stop and start casting for them with whatever, either the same presentation I'm trolling or even a little different one with a, you know, different diving lure, plastic, swim bait, excuse me.
You're fine.
What's that?
I said you're fine.
Okay. And swim baits, you know, crank baits, deep divers, shallow divers, anything that once you find them, you try a variety of, and colors make a difference. You know, some nights they want one particular color and an hour later they want a different particular color because of the moon. The moon phase makes all the difference in the world too.
Is the moon good or bad?
Moon, some people say, oh, I love a full moon. I hated a full moon because you can see everything. They can see, look up and you're a shadow, you know, unless it's really rough or it's cloud cover, you're kind of, you know, flailing, you know. I mean, I fished, you know, so many days during the year, you know, between my dad and grandpa, and when I guided, I seen everything. And I'd take a half a moon. I caught my biggest fish. I think the world record was caught on a half a moon. I loved the half a moon. And I loved, and 3 days before and 3 days after and during, so you had about a week of that half moon period, was the best. Full moon, you had 7 days of, you better hope for rough water and clouds. You know, that's the only savior. But the thing is, now you throw in, I don't care what phase the moon is in, when the moon is rising at night off of the off the horizon, and it gets about a 45 degree angle up in the sky, they'll shut off after it gets higher than that. But from the time it pokes its little head over the horizon, if you're not catching fish, you better get to where there are, because it's going to be hand over fist action as it goes up. And then as soon as it gets right here, you click, hit the light switch, it's done. I mean, and my grandpa and dad told me that, and it went out in one ear and out of the other. Yeah, right. Well, when I had to do it for myself, it may went in that ear, went out that ear, but some of it stayed in my head. And pretty soon I started, you know, I put so much time in that I started realizing that, you know, it didn't matter if it was a quarter moon, a sliver of a moon, a full moon. That is, it didn't matter if it was coming up or if it was up here and I seen it starting to go down and sit like the sun. I was just giddy as all. And I said, okay, when it gets right here, we're going to start catching fish, because I know where we had we were pulling hen's teeth all night long. And I said, we're going to go back over here because I seen fish. We had some hits. We'll get there. Bam, 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 bam. And they go, how'd you know? I said, my grandpa and dad told me, and it still holds true today. And I tell people that now they still go fishing, and I don't tell people don't, but when they see this happening, they know if they're not catching fish, they got to get on fish. And if they were catching a few fish before this started to happen, they better get back to where they caught them, because now they're going. It's just, you know, that's what happens. And so I, it's the little things like that. Just, you know, and I filmed a TV show with the In Fisherman on Lake Erie. And Al Linder goes, oh, we got to film a night show, Mark. I go, fine. And we're fishing a tournament. This wasn't scheduled. We were just talking over the dinner table. And I said, well, we can go right now after we get done. You know, it's going to get dark here real quick. And he goes, well, yeah, we could go down to the west end on the reefs down there. They're really killing them down there. I go, why do we want to drive 14 miles right here at Rattlesnake Island? We're going to catch all we want. Why have you practiced there? I go, well, I haven't practiced down there except, yeah, I practiced for catching them during the tournament, and there's all sorts of big ones here. There's all sorts of fish down there too. We don't need to go down there. He goes, okay. And he goes out and gets his rod, and Jimmy, he's going to be the cameraman, Jimmy Linder, and I get mine. We get the lures, and we get take out everything out of the boat that's in the way, and we head out and head right towards the island, right to the tip. And I says, you're going to let out 85 feet. Well, he doesn't have a line counter. I do. So
can make it tough in the dark.
And he goes, and I'm like, oh man. I mean, he's got the same loot. He's got what I want on there, and he's got it with the right weight on, but I'm like, yeah, you know, this ain't gonna be good. And I just, you know, because I want him to catch fish. And I just happened, I mean, I'm not really, you know, I know we're going to catch fish, but I didn't know there was anything about the moon. I was going to bed about this time. I mean, it's a tournament. We're not fishing at night. And I turned around and I seen the sun, or seen the moon coming up right here. I went, oh my gosh, Al. I says, we're going to kill him tonight. He goes, why is that? I said, see that? The moon's just coming up. I said, but when it gets right here, I said, it's going to shut right off. It, you know, let it go in this ear and out that ear. You know, like, yeah, okay. I mean, we haven't caught a fish yet, and you're telling me we're going to really kill them, and it's going to shut off when it gets up here. And
so that's a recipe for me to not catch any fish if I say we're going to kill them.
and he wants to go to the west end on the reefs, you know, so I know where his heart is. I know where, you know, my heart is. And I go, oh man, there's a fish down there right now. I says, let's keep going. And I, boom, I got him, you know, about 8-pounder, land him.
Nice.
Got him on film, put him back in the water. And he says, let's put him back 85. And I let mine out to 85, and he throws it out again. Boom, I get a 10-pounder. Right, I mean, we didn't hardly go very far. And so he says, after we landed, he goes, do you got a bump board in here? You know, everybody's got a measuring stick.
Yeah.
And I go, yeah. And you know, so many, and he put it up by his reel like that, and, 1 foot right there. Another thing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 85. And then he was right into one right after that. All of a sudden, he's like, we can't just throw this thing out here. It had to be what Mark says it is.
You think the tossing it out there in the splash?
No, it was tossing out there. He wasn't even, who knows where he was. He was
right,
either not down deep enough or he was too deep. So Al got his out to 85 feet this time, and he is fast into one, you know. So, and that was about a 10-pounder. Now he's all happy. And then he is into another one right after that, doing the same countdown process with his reel. And we kept catching fish. And, you know, every, not maybe 20, 30 feet, that's about it. You move about that far, and, you know, I mean, there's fish underneath us all the time. And I looked up, and I went, we don't have much more time, Al. He goes, what's that? I says, it's almost going to, they're going to shut right off right here, right now. Well, it was so hand over fist action. He's looking at me and going, okay, you know, I mean, he half didn't believe me or something, you know. I mean, you know, nobody, he never grew up the way I did, where this is what I did was night fish. So anyhow, it finally got to that point, and we kept going and kept going and kept going and kept going and kept going, and nothing. I didn't say nothing. Kept fishing. He goes, "Mark, we haven't caught a fish in a long time." I says, "Well, look where the moon is." He goes, "Well," he says, "we caught plenty of fish. We got more than enough for a TV show." He goes, "The most important part of this whole thing is what's in your head." He says, "We got to go back, and I got to ask you a whole lot of questions about this, because I can't believe what just happened. And you predicted everything way before it even started, and you predicted it was going to end when it ended, and we never had one more hit after you said it was." And we were catching them hand over fist prior to when that moon hit that point. I said, "It's the way it always been, Al." Al said that was probably the one of the, he said, definitely the best night fishing show he ever got, where he got so much information from me about different little idiosyncrasies of walleye fishing, and you had to do it just perfect, and that, you know, and so that I knew, and I'd stay in a certain depth of water, and so I knew where the lures were compared to where the fish were, and so that was a cool thing, you know. So, yeah, you know, it was fun. You know, you can.
Is that episode floating around somewhere? Someone could find it.
Yeah, I guess. Well, they made it into a VCR tape. It's probably on a DVD now, but that's one of their volumes, the In Fisherman volumes, Night Fishing. You'd look for Night Fishing with Al Linder and myself, and it'll be on a probably a DVD now, not a VHS anymore.
Yeah,
but it was. Yeah, it's still there. I got one somewhere downstairs. So that was cool, you know, and you can take somebody like Al that has the experience that he's had, but he never had that experience, or anybody else ever use that scenario on him for night fishing. And it kind of works for daytime fishing, too, so... Because even in the daytime, you can see the moon rising and falling. Sometimes you can see it,
right?
And it'll disappear. And usually, if it's coming down or going up, even in the daytime, the fishing will be good. Seems to
follow the same rule, not as closely, but
yeah, you're still doing well during that brief few hours.
Yeah. So if you were fishing a tournament in the daytime, would you ever try to hit certain areas at certain times when the moon was going up or down?
Oh yeah. Yeah. I'd, you know, remember, you know, all of a sudden I'd see it, you know, cause it doesn't, you know, have a clock that tells you a moon. I mean, now they got it down pretty good to tell you what days they're going to come up and go down.
Oh, yeah. You back look at a chart and
for
every single day.
Yeah. What time and everything else. Well, didn't have it, and I probably think those slooner tables have something to do with that too. If you looked at the slooner tables and looked at the rising and falling of the moon, whether it's day or night, it probably coincide a lot of it, you know. But it has a longer period with the moon than say those slooner tables are shorter. Their peak time is shorter, where it's peak from here to here with the moon doing that, yeah, especially at night. In the daytime, it's still pretty good, but it can be not, you know, I mean, it can be as hot as it is at night, but it's always going to be better when it's coming up or going down in the daytime than if it wasn't, let's put it that way.
You think that rule holds true for any other fish?
Yeah, you know, that's, you know, I would say bass and everything else too, you know. It's just one of those things that you best not forget where you might have had a couple fish going and now it's slack period going, and all of a sudden, whoa, look at the moon's coming up, you know, in the daytime, or oh, the moon's going down in the day, and you'd hurry up, you know, and it's been slack for a while, you hurry back up to where you maybe had a few fish earlier and now it's going to be turned on again.
Interesting.
Yeah, that's what I always did in the tournaments, you know. I think we were looking at that a little bit in the tournaments this year too, weren't we? You know, and it proved effective, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, it's those little things like that, you know. I might not think, okay, I caught some fish here earlier, but then they quit biting. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't think to go back there, but, well, maybe you should go back to that same spot when the conditions are better and find more fish there again. Because those other fish are probably there for some reason.
Right, right. Yeah, exactly. It's, you know, it might have not been the prime time, but you did catch a fish or two right there, and then they were gone. Well, now it's prime. There's going to be a few more in there because of something was right for them in there, and now they're going to be feeding because the moon is right.
Yeah. Interesting stuff. I think that, I didn't write down too much on my notepad here, but I think we covered all the different things that I wanted to, just kind of your background and what you're up to recently in night fishing. That's something I definitely like to try. I didn't really know much about it, honestly, until I started looking up your background. I never saw you fishing at night on TV as a kid or anything. It was always in the daytime.
So. Yeah. Yeah, it was, that's where I started. I think there was a little episode. I put it up here on my first time out with Fred Trost and Bob Garner.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
it's up on YouTube if you search for it.
Is it?
That would be cool. That'd be cool to see.
Yeah, I think it.
What's your YouTube channel?
It's not on Mark's YouTube, but if you search YouTube for...
Fred Trost and...
Yeah, Fred Trost, Martin. Mark Martin. It should pop right up.
If you just put in the search bar here.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know they have a small amount of their videos up there. I don't know if that's the only one with Mark that's up online or if there are a few more, but
I think there's one in Gunaseo or, you know, a few of them with Fred. Oh, yeah.
When I was growing up, man, those were the shows, Michigan Out of Doors, Fred Trost. It was Red Green on after that.
Yeah, Red Green. Mr. Duct Tape.
He's still doing stuff.
Yeah, they're still making episodes, I think, and he's touring. I love that show.
And I found Mark Trost, 19, Practical Sportsman.
That's probably it.
From here, if you go in the search box, if you do, Fred Trost, Mark Martin should pop up. Yeah.
It's been a little while since I've seen the opening to this show.
That's right there.
1985.
All right, so for anyone that wants to find it and search specifically, 1985.
Yeah.
08-22, Guide Mark Martin Walleye Fishing at Night.
Yeah.
Get a taste of what that looks like.
My first TV show.
This is your first episode?
First ever.
Over here, there's some fellas who are, well, I guess coming in from their fishing. Right now, it's about 11:45, just before midnight.
You guys been Ralph Pike, he's on my pro staff now.
Really?
How was it? Hey, it's rough out there. It's rough out. You're going to have a rough night fishing tonight. Oh, bad news. Bad news. Did you guys get any fish?
Well, we got one rock bass.
You're walleye fishing, I presume.
Yeah, we were.
Well, what's the deal on this weather here? Would you have been out longer if it wasn't rough?
Oh, yeah. We just nicely got started. It wasn't too bad, and then it just picked up and got way too rough for us. So,
so now
it's coming to this, I guess.
Well, what do you think? What do you think about it? I mean, we can't. We don't have the luxury of coming back every night with the cameras. We gotta go tonight. Are we nuts?
No, you're not nuts, but you're gonna have a rough time.
Well, that was not a good omen. We just finished last week's night fishing for catfish, which started in the rain and ended with one very small channel cat. Now we're faced with an evening of high winds. A front had moved through the night before, dumped more rain on Muskegon Lake than a run-of-the-mill rainstorm, and in all likelihood, the fish would be disrupted. We were all a little bit apprehensive, to say the least. But I've always said, never cancel a hunting or fishing trip that you've planned because of a bad weather forecast. And here is why.
Want to go to Strawberry first? This isn't bad. I thought it was going to be really rough.
As it turned out, Ralph and Jerry, who were coming in at midnight because of the wind, should have stayed out. The wind died, conditions were excellent, and we caught fish.
Okay, now I got him free. Oh, I think this is going to be okay. Going to be a walleye.
Oh, great.
Huh?
Looks like one.
It sure does.
Fighting pretty hard.
Yeah, it is. There we go.
Oh, yeah, that's a walleye.
Is it?
Yeah.
Not a bad one, all right.
There you
say,
go.
Mark.
Show me how to fish.
Hey, that's right.
There it is, and that's how you catch a walleye at night.
Yeah, that's how you do it.
Yeah, that is a good one. Well, I think with that, we can shut her down. We'll have to do another one sometime. Maybe talk about some ice fish, and that's actually what I planned on talking about, but I figured have you on for the first episode and get your story.
Well, now you got the my first TV show on top of it.
Yeah,
it looked a little different.
Oh yeah,
a little bit fuller beard.
Yeah, definitely. Anybody listening, just check it out. It's cool to see those old videos, especially if you're from Michigan and grew up watching these old shows. It's pretty neat. But I really appreciate you having me into your office here to record this episode, Mark. Adam, I appreciate you sitting and listening with us most of the time and explaining what you do in the background and making the videos, and
for sure
we'll do it again sometime.
Definitely.
midnight.